as you see in these verses, there is a lot of moving parts. They are indeed heading up to Jerusalem. We're going to see later in Mark chapter 11, Jesus' triumphal entry into the holy city. And this is all part of the process as Jesus and not only the 12, but Jesus and all the disciples are heading up towards Jerusalem to get prepared for Passover. Jesus is obviously traveling here with numerous and many disciples, not just the 12, as I had mentioned. This was common for Jewish people to go to Jerusalem, pilgrimages, as it were. And for those of you that have actually been to Jerusalem, you understand how special of a place that is. You understand the history that's there. You understand that Jesus actually walked on those streets. And so at this time, even though Jesus lived amongst the Jews, Jerusalem to them was still a holy city. That's why they would often talk about going up to Jerusalem. It didn't matter whether you lived north of Jerusalem or south of Jerusalem, you went up to Jerusalem because this is in fact where the temple was. And this is in fact where you went with your offerings to see the high priests. Jerusalem was also the site of God's temple. And as I mentioned, Passover is just about to occur. It's interesting to know, too, as you study this portion of Scripture, that many of these Jews would have been going early for purification rituals. And many of these purification rituals were done with water. And I don't know about you guys, and as rough as maybe the world is at times, I love living in the 21st century. Because we live on this side of the cross. I don't have to go anywhere to get purified with water. I don't have to go through any rituals. I just have to accept the work of Jesus on the cross, and I get to enter into the Holy of Holies. But at this time, none of that was known to them. Of course, Jesus was about to be crucified. He was about to go through this agony, but they still had to go through all these rituals. So again, we see here in Mark's gospel that many of his disciples were amazed. They were actually dumbfounded at times as to what Jesus was able to do and what Jesus was able to present to them and how he was able to speak into their lives. I love the story of the woman at the well in John chapter 4, where Jesus knew how many marriages she had been through. Jesus knew that the current husband that she lived with, or the man she lived with, was not actually hers through marriage. So again, we know all these things of Jesus being involved in our lives and Jesus walking among men at this time. But we also see in this portion of Scripture, they're very afraid for Jesus' well-being. They knew that if Jesus went up to Jerusalem, great harm could come against them because he'd been speaking of these things, not only to the 12, but to the multitudes to whom he ministered. And this was going on as a constant teaching, a constant thing that Jesus was speaking into their lives. But now here we see as well that not only were the disciples with them, the multitudes, but Jesus had this inner circle of 12. And we'll see even that Jesus had an inner circle of 3. And that's where James and John got themselves in a little hot water, as we see here in a few minutes. But isn't it also interesting to note that in verse 33, as we look at this portion of Scripture, that instead of Jesus easing the minds of the 12, he actually ramps things up and intensifies things. He intensifies the conversation. Jesus was not scared of going to the cross, but Jesus was also not scared of telling people what he was about to go through. We need to take a lesson from that. I think as Christians and sometimes as Christian men, we have a tendency to suffer in silence. Jesus was very forthcoming in what was going to come his way. And as Christians, we need to start fellowshipping strong enough with each other, having relationships close enough that we can share with each other what we're about to go through. It is through fellowship, it is through prayer, it is through understanding of other saints that gets us through these situations. So Jesus actually ramps up the conversation, and he gets extremely specific here. He wants to share with the 12 what's going to happen. They will be with Jesus throughout the next several days. They're going to witness a lot of the things. They're going to witness him entering into Jerusalem as the king, as what many thought at the time was going to be the conquering king. And they're going to witness him go through the crucifixion process as well. They are going to be witnesses to this. In fact, some of them were firsthand witnesses that they actually wrote down for you and for me the words that we have here in the New Testament specifically about these episodes that were taking place. But Jesus is also going forward here with the mission of the cross, accompanied somewhat by the 12. But here's the interesting words that he says to them. He says that he is going to be handed off to the chief priests, to the scribes, to the Sanhedrin. And for those of you that have studied Jewish history and Jewish religion, you know the Sanhedrin is made up of the Sadducees, the Pharisees, the chief priests. There are 70 of them in total. And the high priest actually was the 71st person that sat on the Sanhedrin. He was the president of the council. And at the time, even though Jerusalem was in power at the time and overtaken by the Romans, the chief priests and the high priest and Sanhedrin still were able to look after the Jewish religion and look after the temple. Of course, the Sanhedrin's abolished with the fall of Jerusalem in 70 AD. So here Jesus has announced the betrayal of Judas. Judas is going to sell out Jesus. He knows that the council is going to condemn him. Jesus is going to be handed over to the Gentiles, the Romans at the time. And as I mentioned, they'd already taken over Jerusalem. And Herod, in fact, had expanded the temple in Jerusalem. But Jesus is very emphatic now about the upcoming events. And as I was studying this and praying this through, this is what came to mind for me. And this is one thing I want to encourage you to know. That as we read this, and as we see the suffering that Jesus went through, you and I can look on this side of the cross, and we can understand that his pain, his suffering, and all of his agony is over. Jesus no longer has to suffer for you and for me. That is done. So over the course of a few hours, Jesus is taken aside, he's scourged, he's whipped. The psychological torment that he would have gone through was immense. Jesus bled, Jesus' skin was ripped off, and we go through all these things and we realize the agony, and as we read Isaiah 53, we understand the impact of that, but it's over, it's done. We now get to benefit because of the suffering that Jesus went through. Isn't that great to know? It is great for you and I to live on this side of the cross and realize that Jesus no longer suffers. He intervenes for us. He intervenes to the Father. We have the Holy Spirit as a comforter, teacher, and a guide. But again, we have to realize as Christians that we cannot live in a bubble. Reality is reality. When you and I are going to go through mental, psychological, sometimes physical suffering, we need to sit down and share that with others so that they can pray for us and they can pray with us. Although it is difficult at times to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, it is doable. And you and I can do that with the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. But no doubt, again, the 12 are going to be greatly affected by what is about to take place here. We need to take note now in verse 34, the third day he will rise again. I talked about that, about Jesus' suffering being over, how he bled for you and me, how he shed approximately 6 liters of blood. And we also know that as we look in the Luke account, that Jesus actually sweated drops of blood. I did a little bit of research on that as well. That is not as common as most people might believe it is, and yet it is more common than you would like to know. It has been common for soldiers in battle that as they face their potential execution at the front lines, that they have actually sweat drops of blood. And so Jesus did that for you and for me because he knew that the cross was in front of him. He knew that he was going to have to suffer. And that is the anguish that he went through to the point of sweating drops of blood as he prayed in the garden. But we also know that Jesus conquered death. Philippians 2, 8 to 11 says, "And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has also highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, things in heaven, things in earth, things under the earth, and every tongue confess Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father." It's all here. It's all wrapped up in this for you and for me. So as we read Mark chapter 10 and we see the things that Jesus went through, we realize that he is indeed risen and seated at the right hand of the Father. As we move along now, we see James and John, and also as we look in the Matthew account, in Matthew chapter 24, their mother was present. And they approach Jesus, and the first thing that comes out of their mouth is, Messiah, Christ, Rabbi, we want you to do for us what we're about to request. That's a pretty bold statement, isn't it? This is what we're going to request, but we want you to agree to it ahead of time. So Jesus' response is, well, tell me what you want. Like, what do you want me to do for you? And they come up with this outlandish request. And obviously, they must have been volunteering to look after a province or a county, believing that Jesus was destined for greatness and that Jesus was going to be this conquering king that he had talked about. So James and John, being as selfish as they could be in the inner circle, decide to make this request with Salome, their mother, in attendance. And the only one at the time at that inner circle that was not present was Peter. But as we look at Jesus' inner circle and all the misgivings that Peter had and all the mess-ups that he had, he denies Jesus. Have you ever taken the time to sit back and think, why did he pick those three? Why would he pick Peter, James, and John when they're all messed up? I think because he knew we'd be talking about this today. And if he picked those guys, he obviously can use us. So if his inner circle's messed up, he says to us in our humanity, I love you, I trust you. Here's the mission, get out there and make disciples. And we see that example given to us in Matthew 28 and Mark chapter 16. Go therefore and make disciples, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So there are many things I think Jesus did because we would be talking about them 2,000 years later. And there are examples to us that as messed up as we can be in our humanity, he's willing to listen to us. He's willing to guide us. He's willing to allow us into his inner circle. And it's all because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ on the cross. Verse 36 here shows us, though, that Jesus does not assume his royal role. Even though James and John are wanting to be rulers with him, he says, well, what do you want me to do about it? Like, seriously, guys, there's nothing I can do about this. He first of all says to them, hey, what I'm about to go through, can you guys go through it with me? And their response is, oh, yeah, we can do that. And Jesus kind of slows them down and says, well, just wait a minute here. Someday you're going to do this. Someday you're going to suffer. Someday you are going to be a martyr for the sake of the gospel. But at this time, they weren't really ready for this. They were blind to the amount of suffering that Jesus was about to endure. Even in Acts 1:6, they still think that Jesus is going to establish his kingdom. But by verse 9 of Acts chapter 1, he's gone. Acts 1:8, you shall receive power and the Holy Spirit comes upon you. You shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the world. And then in verse 9, he's gone. So within three verses in Acts chapter 1, these guys still haven't realized that he is not about to establish a worldly kingdom as they would view it. Paganism is what they're viewing the kingdom work here. And Jesus' God's kingdom has nothing to do with the pagan kingdoms of the world. It's holy, it's godly, it's just, and they just don't get it. We also see that as we study this, we know that chief ministers of the king would sit on either side of him. And that's what James and John wanted. We see in 1 Kings 2:19 how Solomon built the throne to his right-hand side, and that was for his mother Bathsheba. So it's a place of high, high honor for you to sit at either the right hand or the left hand of a king. And it's extremely rare if that's ever going to happen. But Jesus is about to empty himself and do what it takes for the kingdom. And he asks them if they're going to bear this with him. And obviously they're ignorant without knowledge with respect to this request. They have no idea, even though he's explained to them step by step by step as to what's going to happen. When you study this piece too, you see that Jesus actually uses passive words here. He does not use active verbs. This shows to us that the suffering that's about to take place for Jesus is put upon him and taken by him voluntarily. Jesus is pretty passive and willing to go to the cross. It is laid upon him as the sufferer for you and for me. But as we also noted, the response of Jesus praying in the garden, praying drops of blood, a minister, an angel, comes to him to minister to him at this time. But as you read the Luke account, and as this angel comes to minister to him, comes to strengthen Jesus, Jesus actually cranks up his praying that much more. He even more earnestly prays. And it's at that point where that blood comes. That's another example, I think, for you and for me. That when things have come upon us and we take them to the cross, we still need to pray that incident and that experience through. Jesus did that. Not only is he strengthened and upheld, he cranks up the intensity of what he's about to go through. As we move on now, as we think about the first shall be last, and the last shall be first in the last few verses, we realize now in verse 45 that the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. I absolutely at times struggle with the understanding of these last few verses here in Mark chapter 10 as to what it actually means. I guess, like everybody else, I struggle with pride. I struggle with wanting to get ahead. I struggle with the American dream. I struggle with all those things. And even as Darlene and I went to buy a house now in Calgary after having left here 4 years ago and seeing the house prices, I struggled as to how this all fit into my world, how it all fit into my worldview. What does it mean for me to be last in order to inherit the kingdom of God, or to be first? And if I am first, if I'm arrogant and full of pride, how does that put me into the last position? But Jesus, as I explained a couple weeks ago, often taught with these paradoxes. The first shall be last, the last shall be first. If you want to get ahead in the kingdom, you have to serve. And as you think about Jesus being the king, he actually paid the ransom for us as his subjects. That's backwards. There's a huge paradox in that alone. And yet that had to happen, that somehow the King of Kings and Lord of Lords had to take our place. He had to pay the ransom for you and me because we did not have the ability to do that. There is absolutely nothing we could do to inherit heaven on our own. The King paid the ransom for you and for me. And that's very, very tough for us to understand and to comprehend. Jesus, however, is now saying to this whole group that if you really want to serve in my kingdom, you better suffer, be ready to suffer. If you're called to be a martyr, you're going to have to be a martyr. And as we study this, when we talk about the baptism that Jesus went through, suffering for some of our brothers and sisters in Christ around the world, they are actually baptized in suffering. And we cannot comprehend and understand that. But that's what Jesus is talking about now to the disciples. He's basically saying, you guys made a request that you have no right to make the request of. Part of the request I can't even give to you. And what are you thinking if you really want to inherit the kingdom of God and want to inherit being part of that process? It was also understandable to these men coming out of Judaism and the Jewish religion that they understood as Jews that they were going to be the first people recognized in the new covenant. And yet when the new covenant came, when Jesus came, the Jews rejected him. And therefore, in Acts chapter 10, the house of Cornelius, the gospel then went out to the Gentiles, you and me. But Jesus is now saying to the Jews, to the disciples that although they thought they were going to be first, they're actually going to have to be last if they're going to understand the kingdom. They missed the whole point of why Jesus was coming to earth. They missed this whole point about the future kingdom and an understanding of how this is going to look. So what's the practical application for you and I? As we end today, and before I get Pastor Joel back up to lead us in communion, I want you to turn with me to Psalm 49. Psalm 49 talks about the foolish and how the foolish have their confidence wrapped up in all the wrong places. Psalm 49, hear this, all peoples. Give ear, all inhabitants of the world, both low and high, rich and poor together. My mouth shall speak wisdom, and the meditation of my heart shall give understanding. I will incline my ear to a proverb, and I will disclose my dark saying on the harp. Why should I fear in the days of evil when the iniquity at my heel surrounds me? Those who trust in their wealth and boast in the multitude of their riches, none of them can by any means redeem his brother, nor give to God a ransom for him. Do you see what that said? It says that those who trust in their wealth and boast in the multitude of their riches, none of them by any means can redeem you. The first shall be last, the last shall be first. Verse 8, for the redemption of their souls is costly and shall cease forever, that he should continue to live eternally and not see the pit. For he who sees wise men die, likewise the fool and the senseless person perish and leave their wealth to others. Their inner thought is that their houses will last forever, their dwelling places to all generations. They call their lands after their own names. I was reading the Hershey biography this week. Hershey was a Pennsylvania Dutchman, a Christian. He started the Hershey Chocolate Company, and he named a town Hershey, Pennsylvania. And I was thinking about him this week as I read this. Now, he did it for probably all the right reasons, being a Christian man. But what this is saying here is that foolish people build up wealth for themselves in the here and now. They name towns after themselves. They think that their household's going to last forever. And yet at the end of the day, you all die. And you can't take it with you. When you and I are on our deathbed in our 80s, there's nothing that my bank account is going to do to buy me health to the point that I'm not going to die. So here's my closing thought for you today. As we think of the end of Mark chapter 10 and this psalm, I'm going to invite you to read that whole psalm later. Jesus says to each one of us, first of all, thank you for accepting me as your Lord and Savior. He's happy with that. He's ecstatic with the fact that you've made that choice. But now he's saying to each one of you as a disciple of Jesus Christ, a disciple of his, I need you involved in the kingdom. I need you telling other people about the good news of what you have. But in order for you to accomplish that, you can't worry about your money, you can't worry about your house, you can't worry about your car, you can't worry about being first, you need to be last. Because those that are last will eventually be first. Now I know we all need cars to drive, we all need houses to live in. That's not the point that I'm trying to make here. The point is, you and I, as disciples of Jesus Christ, we need to put his kingdom above everything. His kingdom before our wives or our husbands. His kingdom before our jobs. His kingdom before our children. His kingdom before absolutely everything. We have to be servants to all and for all, because at the end of the day, we're all going to die. And Psalm 49 says that those of you that are rich have not accepted Jesus Christ, your money is not going to save you. You're still going to die, and you're still going to end up in hell. So the focus of these verses that we looked at now in Mark chapter 10 has everything to do with where our hearts are. and where they continually need to be. And I told you at the beginning of this that I struggle with this. I struggle with pride. I struggle with notoriety. I struggle with all these things. But the older I get, the more I realize that if I want to see people come into the kingdom of God today, I have to start putting Jesus in front of my life. If I'm not oozing Jesus to the world, then what am I doing with my life? The first shall be last. I'm going to invite Pastor Joel to come up and lead us in communion. And communion time, ladies and gentlemen, has everything to do with what we've talked about. It has everything to do with Jesus not coming to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for all. This is likely one of the only times in history that you're going to see a conquering king to be give up his life for the subjects of the county. And he did that for you and for me. Because he loves us. And guess what? There's no other way it could have been done. There is nothing you and I could have done for this whole thing to have worked out. It just wasn't going to happen.